what is this optogenetics and how can we use it to target exactly this problem that the cochlear apparatus cannot overcome?
Yeah, no, of course. And so, I mean, just to come back to our issue with the electrical implant, it's very difficult to really focus onto a certain range of the cochlea where the neurons with certain frequency would be sitting because the current spreads so far. And one way of improving that would be if we replace the electrical stimulation by an optical stimulation, you know, so because light can be more conveniently confined in space, we could then, you know, increase the number of stimulation channels, makes them less overlapping, so more independent from each other. And so this is basically the vision that we had since the field of optogenetics really took off. So now the issue is that we believe that we cannot directly optically stimulate the native auditory nerve in the cochlea. So we're not talking the eye, we're talking the ear. And while there is a concept of infrared stimulation that a group in Chicago is pursuing, we think that it's going to be very difficult, if possible at all, to do that, right? Because we need to also watch the energy that we have to put into the cochlea. So we decided that we wanted to explore the opportunity of rendering the nerve cells of the ear light sensitive. Mm-hmm. And here comes optogenetics. It's simply combining the terms opto and genetics, saying that we use genetics to make cells light sensitive and then to sort of manipulate them with light. And the way it works is that we use genetic techniques to express light sensitive proteins. So just imagine proteins that we have in our photoreceptors in the eye, and then basically light hitting these proteins will change their status, and that will change the property of the cell, and in our case, for example, trigger an action potential, so a nerve impulse that then can travel to the brain. And so this is the idea. So and basically we're talking about optogenetic hearing restoration, and because we need the cells to become light sensitive, we need a gene therapy. So we use non-pathogenic viral vectors to bring in the information on the light sensitive protein. And then we also still need a cochlear implant, right? Because mm-hmm. we would need to bring the light to the cells.
So it's a kind of a combination of both, right? It's not only one or two. And also for the people not familiar with these concepts, very often we use viruses which are not virulent anymore, but they are very nice carriers. And we can package our genes that we want to express in a certain cell and eventually have these channels that are photosensitive. Therefore, we use these adeno-associated viruses for this therapy. And they are, to our knowledge, safe to use. Am I correct? Or?
Well, I mean, I think this is true for the clinical trials that have used them, mm-hmm. but we should say that in the inner ear, it is early days, and we just now have the first clinical trials using these viral vectors, the adeno-associated viruses, and it's really, just to be quite clear, these are vectors that do not multiply in the cells. And because our nerve cells are not dividing, you know, there is this notion that a single-time treatment might provide cells with the genetic information once and for a long period of time. But again, this longevity, so how sustained will be the gene therapy, is, you know, up to clinical trials, and we just can collect preclinical work with animals to motivate a clinical mm-hmm. trial.